So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to the cast, which is the wonderful team that worked so hard this week. And they're going to role play their story of what they created.
Where we're going to begin is with Nikki, who is one of our parents whose child has just been discharged from hospital. She has telephoned a friend to actually call her about her experience. We wanted to start by highlighting sort of where we were at the beginning of the week and basically what describes our current state.
Hi, yeah, it's been an awful experience this week in this place, in this hospital. I don't know who's who. I don't know who's taking care of my daughter, Jessie. Nobody talks to each other. They just keep asking me for the same information over and over and over again. Don't they talk to each other? I feel like they don't know what's going on. I don't feel safe. I'm scared for Jessie. I sure hope they have a plan, but I don't know what it is.
So based on that, we would now like to move you into what we want to be the future state, or what we've worked on for interprofessional practice, the ideas that we've been developing this week. So in a way, our overall goal was actually to develop space and processes in which we can be a team, not just a team that spends their time and energy forming and reforming, but to actually have the environment and processes so we can be a team throughout the care of a patient in a hospital. So one of the ways in which we do this was to start off initially by identifying the team. So we define the team as being professionals who engage with a shared group of patients co-located in the same geographic space. The reason we're saying that we want it to be a defined set of people, whether core or extended, and in the shared space, so that we had opportunity to actually develop a community of practice. And it's that community of practice idea that actually allows us to be a team. So within that, then, we actually were talking about geography or space as well. And a lot of this is based on how the Children's Hospital has already been designed. So the idea is that people identify first as their membership with the team and second with their membership as a profession. So there would be an interprofessional private workstation where there's opportunity for charting, other activities that we'll describe throughout the day, confidential meetings, family meetings, and so on. A common break room where team can be built, and then also therapy that's brought up to the areas where patients actually are, and patients and family common rooms so they can actually meet and talk as well. So that is kind of one of our key processes. In addition, we will talk about how we are care being 7 days a week. One of the other things we talked about, how space should be 24/7 and it should be multi-purpose. We have space, we just need to find ways to reuse it so it can be used in more than one fashion. So in terms of our setting, as we said, it's who the team is, our geographic space. The next part of our setting is the nursing team. And so I'm going to hand this next over to Tammy, who's going to unveil the new nursing model. Following this remaining part of the setting, we'll next move into the role play of how a patient will progress throughout all our new processes throughout a hospital stay.
Great, thanks, Heather. So in your minds, envision a big drum roll right now and a big curtain coming down, because that's what we're envisioning, but we couldn't pull it off for this right now. So we are really, really excited. We've worked really hard this week, and it was a stressful week, but things have really come together as Tina promised they would. So what we want to do is show you what we've come up with the nursing model. And what we've done is 6200 and acute care peds both had very different nursing models. Both had lots of strengths. And what we did as a group is we really pulled apart all those strengths that we saw in both models and applied them to a new model. Now we're using a lot of different words and different language, and that's because we don't want people to fall back into what they are used to, what those terms mean to them. And we have created a whole new model, and so we have created a whole new name. So the new nursing model that we have come up with is called patient-centered nursing model. Ta-da! And what it really incorporates is the key concepts and strengths that came from the primary nursing model, as well as the team nursing model. So in order to visualize, because we had a difficulty putting it on paper and what it would look like, and we actually finally just came up with this morning after many drawings and many things going on all week. So we decided it was best for us to try to explain this to you or show you what we've worked through in an organizational chart. And how that works is, starting right up here for the manager, this is how it would look. Now you're not going to recognize any of the titles on here. And again, that is because when we said words like charge nurse or clinical coordinator, people already had preconceived notion of what that meant to them. And it's very different what we realize across one unit to the next and across the region. So what we did is we really looked at what roles, what functions we needed staff to do and what expertise they would bring. So we have some new names here, some new titles. And the first one here, underneath the manager, is the clinical expert. And we see that person being here 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, the clinical expert. And just, you know, at a high level, this would be an expert resource for unit staff, a supernumerary person looking at assigning specific team members to different pods within the unit. Another would be the unit liaison. And we see the unit liaison is, you know, working through capacity and flow systems, triaging admissions, those kinds of things. So two really important key people. And as you see the arrow, that means that they are working together, but they do have definite different roles and priorities. Over here we have the CNE, so definitely a very important part, and the dotted line to the manager as well as to all the staff, meaning that that CNE is there to support them. And we see that as full-time. Underneath the clinical expert is where we break down into our unit staff or our staff and all of our individual pods. And we're just kind of giving an example here just so that we can focus in on one pod or unit. So here we have what we would call a unit leader. The unit leader is an RN, and the unit leader is a person who collaborates with the team to provide the day-to-day care. They are looking after overseeing progression of care, making sure that intentional rounding and things are being done within that unit. It's a real go-to person for the others in that unit. Other staff in that unit may look like another RN, an LPN, or a CCA. And then at the bottom here, lastly but not least, is the happy patient, because with this supportive group surrounding the patient and knowing the patient is happy in the end. We also wanted to bring attention to this, which is our support staff, so unit assist, unit support workers, all important people who also support the functioning of the entire unit. I think next what we'll do is we'll go to our role play that we've worked out so that you can actually see some of these functions, how they would work on the in the unit.
Carla, it has been a long night and I'm very tired and I'm leaving right away. So I just wanted to give you guys a quick report. I have the acuity tool information from last night, and Unit 3 has two new admissions and two patients where their acuity level has changed overnight. Therefore, I've put two RNs, one LPN and one CCA in that unit. Heather is going to be the unit lead. Dana is the other RN in that unit. Cheryl is the LPN, and Teresa is the CCA.
Okay, thank you. In my role, that's to have the overview. We'll have all of the different units. And so we're just going to kind of pass the baton on quickly, because now we're actually going to go to the unit. So that was handover from the two clinical experts and then go into the unit model at this point.
So it's 7:30 in the morning and bedside shift handover is complete. The nursing care team now is going into the unit for a huddle.
So based on bedside report, this is what our assignment for the day is. I'm going to take one of the new admissions and one of the patients whose acuity has changed overnight. Dana, would you please take the other new admission, the other patient whose acuity has changed, and also Sally is going home today and probably later this morning. Cheryl, will you please take these four patients? And Teresa, you will start with our first intentional rounding. Let's gather back to meet at 9:30 and have a great day.
Okay, so now the three primary care nurses are going to organize themselves and get their plan ready and for the patient's day. And Teresa is going to start her first intentional round.
Good morning, Jesse. How are you doing? You must be Jesse's mom? Hi, my name's Teresa and I'm one of the CCAs. We met briefly this morning, but I just wanted to come back and touch base with you. I'm going to be helping the nurses in this unit today with all your care. Did you have good sleep? Not too bad. Do you have to get up to go to the bathroom? You're okay? I see your breakfast is here, and you all set her up for breakfast? Okay. And I see that you need to go to school today. And so the teacher is going to come down to your room. That's what they told me this morning in rounds. So would you like to have a bath or a shower this morning before she comes? Okay, thanks.
So it's now 9:30 a.m. and the nursing team gathers for an update led by the team lead, Heather.
So Dana, how is that patient whose acuity has changed, and anything the clinical expert needs to know?
I think we're still able to manage the patient, the child's care at this time, but I'll keep you well informed of what's going on.
Great. Please let me know when our patient Sally goes home, as we have to notify the ED that we'll have a patient coming up. Cheryl, is there anything new with your patients?
No, my patients are all stable.
And Teresa, how has your morning gone?
I'm pretty much caught up with all the AM care, but I was wondering, Cheryl, could you do the next intentional round?
And then we're pretending there's a little time lapse here. So just pretend. Heather, I just wanted to let you know that Sally has been discharged and that bed is ready, so we're ready to take that next patient.
Awesome. Can you please prepare, and we'll get that new patient coming here.
Okay, so now the unit liaison and the clinical expert discuss the new admission and inform the team leader.
So we talk over the admission, ensure that it's the right room for that patient to come up to, and once we've made that decision, the clinical expert then comes to the team, and I will stay with the team, and we'll just do a brief handover. We're aware of the global of all the patients, so we do a quick handover, and then whether it's the team lead or the other RN, we'll go down to emerge for that patient, and you'll see later on that interaction. But for the continuity, so think of it as, for those that are in lean, the pull system. So we're actually going to be going down from that bed, pulling that patient right back up, and the patient will stay with that team then and have that continuity in their care. And I think we're going to stop at that point, and then at that point we're going to hand over.
Okay, so just to be clear, the clinical expert receives report from the RN, and the RN goes down to ER and starts the admission procedure, bringing the patient up. Okay. Thanks. So just to wrap up our new model, we talked to family member discussing the new model and their perspective, and talking to the happy patient, and she said she felt it was very less confusing. It made her feel good to know that she would know all the members of her team, feel more safe, feel more supportive. We would be coordinating a much increased continuity of care, and that she felt involved in the care with the bedside rounds, shift change, and then the intentional rounds. We then talked within the staff and thought, how is this going to impact the staff, this new model? And the first thing they said was the patient safety would just be so much higher, and they were really excited about that. They would know their patients. There would be that continuity, as well as being able to, the ability to catch errors. Improving communication, the staff felt, they said they felt more supportive, less confusion, increased morale. It allows the nurses to be nurses and know their patients. And they also said that it would be very supportive to a learning environment and mentoring new staff. Even from a manager perspective, I'm really excited by this because it really builds leaders into our system, into every unit, and I think that's really important, and to really showcase that everybody has something to offer, and in this model, everybody's being used to their full extent of their scope and their abilities. One last piece that we did want to show you is that often it's hard to wrap your head around doing things new. And what we wanted to do is really explain that this is really just changing how we work. And the example we use is that 6200 has a really large 12-patient unit. And currently on that unit, they would have two RNs, one LPN, and one CCA. And that's how they would work. One RN would do meds, one would do assessments, and then the LPN and the CCA would do kind of the bedside care. So with the same number of staff and that same number of patients in our model, the two RNs and the LPN would have four patients each based on acuity and within their scope appropriate patients, and the CCA would be there to support them all. And that would be just a much safer way to provide care, and the whole team would meet all the patients. And so it's really very flexibility of staff assignment. We're putting the patients or putting the staff in with the patients that require their needs, and it's dependent on patient acuity as well as staff skill mix and experience and scope. So without adding anyone new into the mix, we're just changing how we work.
Meanwhile, just rewinding slightly a few hours previously, Jessie, 10-year-old young lady, has arrived at RUH. Jessie has a history of asthma and has, in the last 24 hours, had more difficulty breathing. And mom is concerned that this has been a pattern over the last couple of weeks. Increasing school time has been missed and wanted some clarification of where Jessie is at the moment. So the attending physician has decided to admit Jessie, and so starts the process of obtaining or calling for a bed, which will automatically initiate the process of obtaining all the past information that we have on Jessie in our system. That will then be available on the point of care devices that our staff will be using. It also does the call out to the three-person assessment team to let them know that there's a patient in ER that requires to be assessed for the ward. The assessment team consists of three individuals, a physician, an RN, and a pharmacist, as a first portion of the assessment. The interprofessional assessment will be completed using their point of care devices, which will have the assessment on it, and will decrease the amount of duplication of questions that we typically ask our patients. So the team arrives, has a quick meeting, and then introduces themselves to the patient and the patient's mother to begin the patient assessment process. The information that they obtain in their assessment will follow that patient through the hospital stay and will be as part of the permanent record and available to the rest of the team as the patient goes through her journey in the hospital. As a assessment is being completed with the patient and family's input, the plan for the next 24 hours to deal with the issues is being developed. Referrals are being initiated, orders are being processed, and a discussion about the length of stay estimated this time for Jessie will be discussed with her and her mother.
Okay, so now consider that an appropriate period of time has gone by, and we're now going to provide an orientation to the patient, to the ward, and to the 24/7 progress of your care model. So, Jessie, know that patient and family participation is a key component of our model. We will ensure that the care that you need is there when you need it. We've heard from you and your fellow patients about your concern that the levels of care you receive fluctuates depending on the day of the week or the time of the year. And we're now in a system where all care team members are available for your care 7 days a week. And if a care team member is away because of illness, vacation, or other reason, there will always be a replacement scheduled so that you do not have to wait needlessly for the progression of your care. So, First off, we want to give you a bit of an orientation and an overview of our ward. We want you and your family members to feel comfortable here and that you know about things such as cell phone usage policies, where to store your valuables, where you go for things like showers, snacks, or family time, and what about parking. We want you to know and feel comfortable asking questions about your care and your care team. We promise to answer all of your questions just as soon as we can. We want you to know who your care team members are and what their roles are in your plan of care. We want you to know that the care that you need will be available 24/7. You will be able, and I guess just as an aside, this paper thing is a representation of electronic means of communication, whether it's a smart board or a smart TV or a whiteboard, so that, and along with an appropriate input device so that you don't have to get up to see and read about your care plan. So you'll be able to see your plan at any time. And you can see the information about you that's in your plan, and if you need to add to it or update it, you can. And you can see if your care progress through your stay, and you'll be able to, in fact, you'll be asked to provide input with respect to your plan of care. At shift change, and that's when the nursing staff change and actually get to go home every once in a while, you'll be asked whether or not you want that shift change to happen at your bedside. And if you don't, if you find that it's uncomfortable or perhaps a little tiring, then it won't happen. But certainly you have the choice. You'll be asked about your plan throughout your stay. And one of the reasons why we ask questions is because we are a teaching hospital, and we really want to make sure that we can provide enough training for caregivers so that you receive the quality care that you receive. We will check to make sure that you know about your plan of care. We understand, and we want to know about your concerns and your suggestions. And we also want to provide you the assurance that your concerns will be acted upon and your questions will be heard. Your voice matters. Our goal is that we do nothing about you without you. And we will commit to knowing you as a person as well as a patient.
After an appropriate amount of time of orientation has sunk in, the healthcare professional will come to the patient and family and start to teach them about their own personal plan or goal development. So the healthcare professional will enter the room and highlight the patient and family's personal wellness goals and how they are important to their care team. So these goals and plans that have been set will be discussed, and the care team will rally around the patient to try to help the patient achieve those daily plans or wellness goals. The healthcare professional will then teach the patient how to input their goals for the day. It will be available on their smart board, and each day the plan is discussed and progress is reviewed. The patient and family have the opportunity to review previous daily plans and the progress. It can be inputted in a variety of different ways. So you could type it, you could speak it, you could record it via video, as well as have translation if needed. So that way that there are many methods for many different patients and many different patient needs. In addition, the patient and family will be able to give information to the care team that will be relevant to their care. This is critical because it eliminates the repetitive dialogue that often occurs and ensures safety. This information links directly to the patient's chart and will be part of a discussion at rounds and handoff. The patient and family have the ability to add this at any time with an alert going to that patient's chart for the care team to be able to discuss. Any questions that the patient and family have can actually be added as well and flagged for the care team so that when they do their intentional rounding, that can be discussed also. The patient and family have the opportunity to send all this information to other family members who may not be in the same geographic location or not available at the time when the intentional rounding occurs. It is important to note that the patient and family have visibility to their plan, their care, their milestones, and they also have an idea of what their schedule and their day looks like so that they can see ahead. It is important to know that just because it looks like a smart board that it can't happen today or tomorrow, that there's a paper copy for those who are maybe fearful of new technology, an ability to still input that data on their personal chart, on their personal care plan, to make sure that their voice is heard. And all of this information, which is key to the patient's wellness, will be utilized in the development of their milestones for wellness and transition plans for the patient that is transparent and reviewed on a consistent daily basis. And this will help when they leave the acute care facility.
Our group was involved in the process of handover. Two standard tools were developed, one for unit-to-unit transfer being, one example would be ED to the ward, and the other one is for shift-to-shift report. Our handovers here will occur at the bedside. For today, we'll demonstrate the shift-to-shift report. Three key principles that we want to point out is that for any handover, patients and families will be involved in whatever level they are most comfortable in a language that they can understand. Information in the care plan needs to be both current and reliable. A standard method of relaying the information is through our scripted tools.
So I'm the night nurse, and I'm going to prepare to give oncoming report, our day shift report to the oncoming nurses. 1 hour prior to my shift change, I'm going to do an intentional round of my patients, just basically seeing if anybody needs turning and positioning, if there's anybody that needs to go to the bathroom, if there's anybody that needs pain meds given, just so that it will help to somewhat hopefully decrease any interruptions during our shift change report. Good morning, Jesse. Good morning, Nikki. These are your nurses for the day. Rachel's the RN and Heather is the CCA. Is it all right if I give them report at your bedside? Is there anything, if there's anything that you'd like to add or correct during report, please feel free to speak up. If you have questions, we will make sure to note them on your smart board and your care team will come back after report to address them, okay? I, as a nurse, would then proceed to give my report following our bedside scripted report. So I'm going to do that. So is there anything else that you'd like to add to what I just told Rachel and Heather? Okay, good. And then I would probably ask, depending on what we've decided as our groups, if they'd like to be involved in the interdisciplinary rounds, as a little bit that as my night shift, that might be fall onto the day shift people. I don't know that we've 100% decided that.
So now that we are done report on you, we're just going to go ahead and finish report on the rest of the patients, and then Heather and I will be back in.
So before leaving the patient's room, the team then would update the whiteboard with names, dates, goals, questions, etc.
Of this process are the actual interprofessional rounds or meetings. And again, we had a lot of trouble with terminology because there's so many associations linked. If we use words like rounds and if we're trying to create new things, we often had to create new words. So one of our first processes would be first thing in the morning, in which there would be an interprofessional check-in. And at this point in time, it would be more for the responsibilities of the day would be established by all members of the team.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome. It's 9 a.m., and we are right on time for our daily interdisciplinary check-in. Like every day, we have our core team of healthcare providers, as well as our extended care team. So to start off the day, we have 13 patients to see as a team. On my pre-rounds this morning, Mrs. Peters, Billy's mom, doesn't want to be seen by the whole team, but would like to be seen by social work later.
Yes, I'm scheduled to see him at 12:30.
And also Mr. Johnson, Susie's dad, will be in a little bit later and doesn't need to see the whole team today, but he would like to see the dietitian today.
Yes, the referral's been made, so I'm going to check with the family and make time to see them.
So we have a new patient, Jessie, a 10-year-old girl who was admitted with an asthma exacerbation. We have no new nursing concerns from overnight, but her mom, Nikki, is here and mentioned that she's a little bit concerned about her missing school. So looking at our visual management board or patient status at a glance, I see that we have asthma teaching at 11 a.m. and social work scheduled for 1400. How are we going to coordinate the rest of the care today?
Well, as the hospital school teacher, I will be in at 1 if that works for the family to help them with those needs.
Perfect. Sounds very good. So from here, we'll go about doing our individual assessments and treatments. We'll get back together at 10:30 and start our team rounds, and we will begin with Jessie and her mom. So just to clarify, this type of a conversation will take place for all of our patients on our care team, but for the interest of today, we will skip that. And now we will have a time lapse of approximately an hour and a half to allow our staff, the staff, to go do some assessments and treatments. And we will meet up again at about 10:30 as we decided here at the patient's room. Knock, knock, knock.
Wash your hands.
Washing. Good morning, Jessie. Hi, Nikki. How are you guys doing?
I'm good.
Good. So as we told you about, we're here as a team to discuss your daily goals and progress. So as we're planning with you your goals today, we'll make sure that they're visible to you on either your smart board or the whiteboard, whatever you prefer. And before we leave the room, we will review them as a team and make sure that we're moving forward with one plan. And then from here, we will do our team round.
Our group looked at 24-hour coordination of care and progression of care. This new community of practice will provide culturally appropriate, patient and family-centered care, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. This means that we will have the same access to care and the same standard of care, as well as access to tests 7 days a week, and when possible, therapies and tests will be scheduled. This team is interprofessional, visible, consistent, accessible, and tied to the patient throughout their stay. A plan for the day and a plan for the stay is visible at a glance. The team can advance care in a coordinated fashion because the patient goals are visible to the team. In addition, the bedside nurse can identify concerns early and activate team members. As a part of the interprofessional bedside round, the team progresses a clear, mutually agreed upon transition action plan.
Okay, now we're going to pretend this is the next day and we're doing our bedside rounds again. So we'll come in and we'll introduce ourselves to the patient. I'm Laura, I'm one of the nurses working today. We'll review our nice 8x10 picture so she can put faces to the team members. And as a goal of having transition planning be throughout the stay, kind of our conversation pieces for our rounds will kind of be geared towards thinking of going home or to the next transition. So the first question would be, do you understand your health condition? And if they don't, then there'll be room for education. We'll make a note on that, and it can go on our board in the hallway. Do you know what each of your medications do? Okay. Yes, you do. Do you need any equipment? Do you know what signs and symptoms to watch for? Do you know what provider to call if you have problems? Do you know which tests and consultations you will have coming up? And then for the family, we could ask them, do you know what help your loved one will need on for them when you go home? And do you know how to do the tasks you need to do? Okay. And we'd update the board as necessary. Any red flags that came out of this, we could come and put on the board. And as a part of our intentional roundings at 2 o'clock, the nurse in the unit will come back to the board and see if there's anything outstanding. If it's red, I'll see that it hasn't been done. And this is my red flag to contact the necessary professional and see what we can do to make a plan to make that happen.
Okay, our group was charged with the plan of care overall and some of the logistics surrounding that. So what we actually found was when we came together as a larger group, a lot of our what our table was working on came in at a lot of different time points throughout this patient flow. So what we decided to do, rather than break up this overall flow and confuse the audience, was to just bring forward some of the overarching themes that we found came out of the role play and maybe didn't come out in some of the detail in the process. So these are some of the assumptions that we're making and some of the overarching themes. We're working in a world with an electronic medical record. Imagine that, any of the frontline caregivers here today. And any place that you saw any transfer of information throughout this role play today, the idea is that this is all one single document. Any information that's coming and being built into the patient's single document care plan is being pulled at different time points and built into other parts of the patient's, or any information that's generated on that patient. So this would include some of the common patient record, any active issues and goals, the progress notes, and then again, pulling some of that information into a transfer of care document, whether we're transferring that patient into the community or to another facility and whatnot. Another overall assumption or overall theme is that all of this is being done in real time. All of the information is being updated in real time. It's available at the patient's bedside, being updated on their smart board, for example, in real time, so that there's no delay of that information being communicated. Obviously, the patient goals are at the forefront of this overall process. So this may be daily goals that we want to try to accomplish. This may be longer-term goals. And the hope is that there's some sort of visual representation of progression towards that goal, whether that goal is transfer to community or whether that goal is, I want to walk 30 meters today, whatever that is. Another overarching theme was that there's no duplication of a lot of the questions that we ask throughout a patient's stay in hospital, so that if that information is available in real time and it's all being fed to the same document, we don't have to repeat some initial past medical history, for example. And then just as kind of a side note, the hope again is that all of this information is customizable to the patient's experience in terms of what do they want to see displayed on that whiteboard? How do I, as a pharmacist, want that profile to show up when I have my point of care device and I'm interviewing and talking with the patient and family?
I feel like I should do a little curtsy or something right now. I'm Mary Lee Simpson, and I'm a patient advisor. I'm new to this role as of February of this year, and my medical experience in your healthcare system and mine has just been over the last 2 years.
I'm Heather Thiessen, and I just have to say I'm always in awe on 3P events. This is my third 3P, and they're always wacky and they're always crazy, but they always come together. And this one is really near and dear to me because it's really showing how patient and family-centered we are and having patients and families part of that team. And anyone who knows my story, it's something I've wanted for 16 years. So this is incredible. So I can't wait to see how we go from here. And I know this will happen, and I'll be there to cheer you all the way.
My name is Erin Burr, and 5 years ago, I was thrown into this life. You know, like I had no choice. Here I was. I have a five-year-old with chronic medical condition, so I spent a great deal of time at the hospital, and I came here with all sorts of assumptions about what it was going to look like. It's completely different than I thought it was going to be, but in such a good way, and it's amazing how we have so many different interdisciplinary people and, you know, everybody from every part of the hospital that's able to sit down at a table and come up with a plan. You know, the seven days a week thing is huge for me, because if you're in the hospital and it's Friday and it's 3 o'clock, you know you're staying there all weekend and you have to wait till Monday before speaking to anybody, and it's just like, oh shoot, it's 3:30, forget about it, right? Also coming into eMERGE, like if my son's sick, I try not to take him in if it's near the end of the week, because I know I'm just going to be sitting in the hospital for the whole weekend. So if I can do that at home, I'll just try to do it at home and tough my way out that way. Now I know that's not going to happen anymore. You know, it's Saturday and Sunday, just like every other day, which is so awesome. That's the part that I'm most excited about, along with a whole bunch of other stuff that's come up here. I can't wait to see it in action.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Charmaine Pajkic. I'm also a patient and family advisor. I've had
experiences in the healthcare system, so that it's great to be involved in an experience like this. Everybody did such a great job in participating and having their input. I just want to thank everybody for actually involving the patients and the families in this process. It means a lot to us, especially to me. Thank you.
I'm not done. Put a microphone in my hand and I'm ready to go for another hour. No, that's not true. This was my first P3. I'm starting to learn the, you know, acronyms and the jargon. But at the very beginning on Monday morning, we were asked about our expectations and our fears. And my expectation for the week was that the patient and family voice be heard. And my fear was that it wasn't going to be heard. And we did. Every time we offered an opinion, I think all of us felt that our experience was validated. We were heard, our concerns were heard, and going forward, we all feel that we're going to be more of an important part of our own care or our child's care. So thank you very much for inviting us. At the next one, I would hope to see a wider variety of patients on your advisory team for these things, so that you get a little bit more of a spectrum of patients.
We also had Michaela Booth, who was here for most of the time. She just went home a little bit earlier today. And we did do on Tuesday night, we did a teleconference with broader patients and families to get their input into things. And again, this group brought those voices back to the table and to inform us. So thank you, ladies, for your work. The next piece that we did today was we took where we want to be and we took what we envisioned and we started to work back and started to say, okay, what are those things we can do next week? What are those things that might look electronic but we can test on paper? What are those next steps if we want to get to that model of the tri-admission? What are those pieces we need to understand and to test and to see if some of the ideas we have actually work in practice and begin to do some of that testing? I know some of the groups have said, okay, like in August we can try this. So part of it was bringing down this big list of all the details of all of those concepts and functions that we did and beginning to bring them down. We'll bring this back and look at the integration across and begin to start to write to really align that. I know there's some things that as Graham and I are talking align somewhat with some of the ED flow work. There's stuff that's linked with the Children's Hospital. There's stuff with e-health that we're doing. So the other piece we need to do is say, who are those other stakeholders that we can help engage with and really learn about some of the work we did this week? So just to close, I just want to say, again, I say thanks to the Family and Patient Advisor, but I really do want to say thank you to all of the professionals, all of the staff that came this week. It is not an easy thing to do. I think there's always lots of skepticism around, will my voice be heard? There's always worry about whether what I say might be changed or done something different. And so I think it does take courage to come and participate and engage in this, because it could be very easy not to. So I just do want to say, not only were the patients and families courageous, but the discussions and the challenging discussions that happened this week with the staff were really important. And really, an interprofessional team really isn't a team that doesn't have controversy or doesn't challenge each other. A real interprofessional team actually puts things on the tables and works through them for the best of the patients and families. And I thought that I saw that illustrated in spades this week with this group. So finally, I'd like to thank our consultants, Tom and Tina, for taking us through the week, and all of the facilitators in the room as well, who really helped us move us forward in the week. So thank you, and happy Friday.